This is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. My guest in today's episode is my friend, Dr. Paul Etchison. And we're going to talk about his journey that he calls dental practice hero, from ordinary practice to extraordinary experience. You know, Paul's written a book by that same title. It's an amazing book. And we're going to talk about some of the content in that book and how he developed an extraordinary experience in his practice in Illinois. Hey, before we get to that interview, though, I want to remind you to jump in on our I Love Dentistry Facebook group. This is a Facebook group that does just what the title says. It's all about people who absolutely love dentistry and who are passionate about our profession. I'll put a link in the show notes. Click on that link. It's a closed group, so you have to request membership, and then we'll let you in. In the question that says, where did you hear about the I Love Dentistry group, tell them it was the Thriving Dentist Show podcast. Look forward to seeing you inside that group. You know, also before we get to Paul's interview, we have another top clinical tip from Dr. Leanne Brady. In this top clinical tip, Lee talks about her oral cancer screening protocol and how that's changed over the years to be absolutely state of the art. I think you'll enjoy this top clinical tip from Dr. Leanne Brady.
So in our clinical tip, I'm going to totally switch gears, and I actually want to talk about looking at your oral cancer screening protocol. And, you know, I've actually looked at this several times over the last couple of years in my practice. My patient population tends to be older adults, and I don't know if I see more challenges with this, but several years ago, I actually got technology in my office. So I actually have a Velscope in my office, which I absolutely love. Of all the different technologies that I looked at, for me, this was the most patient friendly because I don't have to have the patient swish with a mouthwash or a dye or anything. And it's really easy. You just plug it in, charge the battery, and then you just look through. It's a special light, and it illuminates things in the mouth that are inflammatory. And so, and they'll teach you how to differentiate between it's just inflammation, so you can press and it will blanch, versus it looks that way in the Velscope and it doesn't blanch. You should be worried about it. So we've really tried to sort of up the ante around our oral cancer screening. And even honestly, as of like 3 weeks ago, I actually had a patient come in to have a crown re-cemented. And when she was in the office, she said, oh, by the way, I've had a sore on the side of my tongue for 3 months. Well, if something that doesn't heal for 3 months is a big red flag. Mm-hmm. Look, she has a sore on the side of her tongue that's the size of a quarter, and send her immediately to the oral surgeon for a biopsy. But one of the things that it got at top of mind for me, and I remembered that I had seen a lady present at a dental meeting, and she is actually an oral cancer survivor, and she had done just an absolutely phenomenal job. So I went and I looked her up on the internet after this patient was in my office, and lo and behold, she actually has this really phenomenal website that's called sixstepscreening.org. And so if you go to sixstepscreening.org, you'll find her website and you can read her story if you want. But what I loved about it is it actually is a website designed to help us who are healthcare professionals and patients learn how to do a really simple, quick oral cancer screening. And she has a really phenomenal couple of videos on there. And we actually watched it in our team meeting just the other day. And it was great, quick, easy, but it was such a great refresher of just easy ways to look and make sure that we're catching any evidence of potential oral cancer in our patients. So I'm just in my clinical tip this week, I guess what I'm saying is, when's the last time you reviewed your office policies for oral cancer screening and maybe even did an in-service with your team? And if it's been a while, this sixstepscreening.org is a great resource.
You know, Lee, we're doing this extemporaneously, and I didn't know that this was going to be your top clinical tip. But if I may comment on that, we now know that the incidence of oral cancer is going up dramatically. As recently as about 4 years ago, the number of oral cancer cases in the U.S. was about 30,000 a year. And now just 4 years later, it's about 44,000 a year. We also know that in the last 5 years, fully 50% of the diagnosed oral cancer cases have come from patients outside of what you and I would consider to be the traditional at-risk group.
And, oh, absolutely.
So I really appreciate you bringing this to attention. I'll put in the show notes the six-step screening.org resource so for all of our listeners can find that in the show notes so they can go check that out. Thanks, Lee. This is actually going to save lives, and thanks for making it top of mind for all of us.
Oh, my pleasure.
Well, I mentioned in the intro that my guest on today's Thriving Dentist Show is my friend and fellow podcaster, Dr. Paul Etchison. Hey, Paul, how are you?
Hey, man, doing good. I'm on the podcast. I mean, I've been a longtime listener and really excited to be on. Thanks for having me.
It's mutual. I was super excited about getting you scheduled. Hey, we're going to, just to kind of knock the top off our topic for our listeners' benefit, we're going to talk about your book, and it's called The Dental Practice Hero, From Ordinary Practice to Extraordinary Experience. And I'm just going to come right off the top and say that your book should be required reading for any dentist interested in having a thriving practice.
It's amazing.
It's a wonderful read. Lots of pearls, lots of great information told in an interesting way. So good work, man.
Thank you. Thank you. Appreciate that.
And in fact, we're going to talk about your book and kind of share some of the concepts with our listeners so that they can go out and apply some of the stuff and become a dental hero in their own right. I do want to tell our listeners about your podcast. If you like the Thriving Dentist Show, you would also like Paul's. His is called the Dental Practice Heroes Podcast. Hey, tell our listeners a little bit about your podcast.
Yeah. So we've been going about a year and a half. We try to stick to mainly practice management, business stuff. We don't really get into clinical too much. A lot of it ends up being communication things. So we have on a guest every other week. And then every other week, I also do an episode where I just talk about something from my book or something I'm thinking about. But it's all applicable where you can just turn around Monday and apply it and implement. So try to make everything usable. We try to stay away from the fluff and just make everything just really good, valuable content.
Yeah, the best kind, right?
Yeah.
I know many of our listeners will recognize your name, Paul, but in case, and we do have listeners in 176 countries, so it's possible they haven't heard of you. Would you be kind enough to share a little bit of your backstory about what brought you into dentistry?
Yeah, sure. I graduated in 2009. University of Illinois, Chicago, and I'm in the Chicago area. I'm about 40 miles south of Chicago. A lot of people think I'm in the city. I'm actually not in the city. I'm like right where the south suburbs end. So if you go just about a mile south of me, it's all farms. So it's not really in the city. I'm in the suburbs, but I did a startup about 3 years out from school, and we're about 7 years into my startup. We've grown very fast. We had 5 ops. Got that to capacity. We just expanded to 11 ops just in October. So it's been, now we're kind of a mega practice, I guess you would say, but it's been a challenge, but it's been fun. You know, we got 25 employees now. I got 2 associates. I got a specialist in there, and it's been keeping me busy, but it's helped that I went down on the clinical days. I'm down to 2. I've been a 3-day dentist for a very long time. And just recently, about a month ago, I went down to 2 days, and that's helping me grow the business a lot more. But I just really like dentistry. I like the practice management aspect. I really love clinical. I found myself more leaning towards the entrepreneurial, the management aspect, mm-hmm. but I'm not going to say that I hate dentistry or hate the clinical. I still like doing that. It's just when you have that many people and you're doing a machine that's as big as mine, you got to spend some time on it. And it's hard to when you're seeing patients all the time.
Right, right. Well, I commend you for your success at doing a startup. And if I heard right, it was about 3 years out. So around 2012-ish, 2012, 2013.
Yeah, April 2012. That's right.
So, hey, we have listeners all the way from pre-dental all the way to very senior doctors in their career. And under that adage of if it's been done before, it must be possible. Mm-hmm. It's still possible to do a startup, isn't it?
It is. Absolutely. And I, looking back, I wouldn't have done it any other way. It was awesome. We had an awesome culture from the get-go. We grew, and every time we hired a new employee, they came into a great culture. And I think that was part of what made us so successful, is that we just really harped on that culture as we grew and just stayed on top of it. So it was a fun ride.
Give our listeners the elevator pitch of your practice. In other words, if you were to bump into someone at, say, a Chamber of Commerce meeting, and they said, "Hey, Dr. Etchison, tell me a little bit about your practice. How would you kind of elevator pitch your practice and tell them what it's about?"
Well, I would tell them that we're very high tech. You know, we got all the latest technological stuff. When we're talking to patients, digital x-rays, I know we don't, as dentists, think that's very high tech, but got a cone beam, CEREC, iTero scanner. We do most procedures in-house. There's not a whole lot that we refer out. I handle most of the molar endo. I have a surgeon in there that's doing all the wisdom teeth and stuff. So we try to keep everything in-house. But I would say what makes my practice really stand out is that we just really are hyper-focused on the patient experience. So I had somebody that runs a local, another business, and they were saying, they're a patient. They said, how do you find these people that are so nice? Like, why is it so great at your practice? I just don't get where you find these people. We have so much trouble hiring. And I kind of told her, you know, a lot of what we do, not that it's scripted, but it's very staged, meaning that we use certain words, we talk about things a certain way, we touch people on the shoulder at certain times, like when we greet them and we walk out of the room, we answer the phone a certain way. It's just, there's so many little things that are done, like even going as far as the room is set up in a certain way before the patient even walks in, like with the assistant chair is in a certain spot, it's facing a certain way, the provider chair is going a different way. You know, it's very, we're just very intent on providing the best patient experience that we can.
It's very intentional. And a lot of what you do has a lot of intention to it.
Yeah, for sure. And when we read, we just passed 600 Google reviews, so we were proud of that. But
good for you.
When we read them, it's not all about me. It's mostly about my team and how nice everybody is there. So I can't say that it's me making all this happen. I mean, I know the leadership has part of it, but it's the experience has to do with a lot of my team and what we do together and how we all collectively provide that experience.
Right. You title the book The Dental Practice Hero. And early in the book, you talk about the hero's journey. And those of us that are familiar with literature will recognize the hero's journey in literature, also in movies and theater. But there might be some listeners that are not familiar with the hero's journey. Would you give a short summary of that?
Yeah, I mean, more or less, it's that, you know, you don't think you're good enough. You get a challenge. You go out there. You know, you get beaten down a little bit. You meet a mentor. You learn new things about yourself. And then you go back a changed person and you can change the world. I mean, that's it in a nutshell.
With a cape on, though.
Yeah.
You got to have a cape.
Of course. Of course.
And a sword. And a sword.
Absolutely.
And I should give reference to this because this is in audio form, but I literally am holding a copy of Paul's book in my hand. And there's a cover that has a character. The dentist, with a cape on and holding a sword. So there you go. Hey, we all want to wear capes and hold swords, right?
Yeah. What did you say, Gary? I'm sorry.
We all want to wear capes and hold swords.
Oh, yeah, of course.
So, you know, the reality is that many practices are ordinary practices.
Yeah.
And I imagine there'll be some listeners that are saying, truth be told, it's kind of ordinary, but they want to change it. And I love the way your focus is on, really a couple things, you know, many things, but there's two that kind of stand out to me: communication and experience. Communication mm-hmm. and the experience. We like to call our new patient experience, we call it a remarkable new patient experience. Mm-hmm. And we use that term in the literal sense that, you know, when someone says, "Oh, that was remarkable," you know, what does that mean? It was really good. But we also kind of use it in a 21st century vernacular of when someone's had a great experience, they want to go out and remark to others about how great it was. And today people do that by online reviews, and we hope Google reviews.
Yeah.
So, hey, walk our listeners through that journey from ordinary practice to extraordinary experience. And then we'll kind of dive down into some of the subtopics within that.
Yeah. So when you get the book, it's kind of separated into two different halves. The first half being a lot of the leadership, a lot of the communication things about what to do with your team, how to handle your team, how to grow a great team. And I mean, I can't stress the team enough. And I talked about this a little bit at Voices of Dentistry, mm-hmm. is that we get hung up in systems a lot when we realize, you should realize that if you just have a great team, if you just really focus on your culture and your team and your vision and just, you know, just working together, that you don't have to worry so much about the systems because the team will create the systems, you know, right. with the communication, with the right communication, having meetings, talking about what's not working, what's working well. Your great team will create the great system. So my first part of the book is pretty much all about that. And then the second half of the book, I break it down into seven different categories of systems. And I'll just go through them for the listeners. It's phone skills, patient experience, financing is the third system, scheduling, clinical skills, which is just like the implementation of the production, just doing the work, collections, and then the last part, which is just recall and reactivation. And the second part of the book just goes through all the systems that I have in my practice, how we do things. And just, it's all just a conglomeration of all my experience and all the different classes I've taken and pretty much everything I've learned the hard way. But I think it's really, I think someone could buy the book and really have the same practice as me, because I'll tell you, my original title was, "Why Does Your Practice Stink When It's So Stinking Easy?" but the editor didn't like it and they talked me out of it. And I kind of, part of me wishes I would have just called it that, because that's still kind of where I'm at with the book. I mean, it's hard. It's hard running a practice, but there's certain things you can do that really make a big difference. And not to go on a tangent, but at Voices of Dentistry, I talked about psychological safety and how we just often just train our teams not to communicate with us. And when people are scared to communicate because they don't want to look stupid or they don't want to look incompetent, right. we create this quiet place in our practice where we don't get anything. We don't get any traction anywhere because everyone's scared to take a risk. So I think that just comes back to the communication piece, but that's foundational. But a lot of dentists are looking for that magic bullet. Like, what if I just do this? If I do that, I think it's got to start with the leadership stuff. So that's what the first half of the book is. But it does go through the systems for the people that want to know the systems. And I've got good feedback on the book and I'm proud of it. And I actually did write it. I didn't ghostwrite it. I didn't have anyone else do it for me. I actually sat down and spent a lot of time writing it. So right. Happy with the product.
No, it's a great book. And like I said, should be required reading for any dentist that wants to have a thriving practice. You know, I want to piggyback on something you said about the first half of the book being the importance of team and culture and having everyone on the same page. Just today, I ran a team meeting for my practice, my Life Smiles practice here in Phoenix. Mm-hmm. And Paul and Tim and I alternate leadership in that team meeting. We do what in most practices is called the staff meeting. I never use the word staff because staff's an infection, or it's a stick. It could be either one, an infection or a stick. And I like to think that I'm not working with infections or sticks. So we like to use the word team. We're a team of 15 full-time team members. Paul, Tim, and I make 18. And so every other Wednesday, we do a 2-hour team meeting. And so today was my turn to run the team meeting. And one of the things I did today, Paul, was kind of fun. And I'll let out the consultant's dirty little secret. Is it okay if I let that one out of the bag?
Yeah, I think you should.
So here's what every consultant doesn't want you to know. And that's that practices don't really need consultants. they don't. I'm just true confessions here. They really don't. Doctors, if you just sat down and created an environment where it was a safe environment to communicate, just ask your team members what we need to do to improve, and they'll tell you.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't need a consultant. And so some of you are thinking, well, Gary, that's heresy. You're a consultant, or you're virtually just, cutting off your, you know, opportunity to grow right there. And I said, no, and I actually, no. But I truly believe that practices don't need a consultant. Now, they can benefit from one. they can certainly benefit. Oftentimes a consulting coach can bring in a different perspective, can create some accountability, can provide some vision and direction that, that might not be there, can maybe show you some things. I mean, I've physically been in over 2,200 practices as a coach, so I've certainly seen some things. So you can certainly benefit, but most practices don't need one if they could just listen to their team. So I did an exercise today in our team meeting where we literally went around the table with all 18 of us, and I asked the question, if there was one thing that we could do to make this practice a better place, what would it be? And, I said, while you're thinking, I didn't ask him to prepare ahead of time. I want it to be spontaneous. And I said, it could be a big thing, like something maybe on your wish list that you wish we had, or it could be something that in your mind, you're thinking maybe this is small and trivial, but it could make a difference. And we literally went around the room, and it was so interesting to hear our team members with unbelievably insightful suggestions.
Yeah.
And we, you know, Paul, Tim, and I ended up with, three pages of digital notes that, by the way, we will implement over our next handful of team meetings.
Yeah. And it's amazing how many people don't sit, they just don't ask. Yeah. And I mean, I remember one time I always advocate having like private meetings with each team member, like just bring them in the office and say, hey, what's working, what's right. not working. And I remember my insurance coordinator saying, you know, I'm just kind of burnt out and I'm not really thinking that I want to do this much longer. Like literally told me that she's thinking of quitting. And it was amazing to hear. But then we sat there and we talked about what is going on, like why, like what's happening. And it was just that she had too much of a workload. She needed some help. And the way that we were doing the insurance verification was just not very efficient. But I don't know that. I'm not at the front desk, you know. Mm-hmm. And it was just kind of a really eye-opening experience for me just to see, hey, man, you've got to ask what's going on. I mean, with the assistants, with the hygienists, right. we often know what's happening because we're with them all day long. But the front desk, you just never know. And I think one of the things that we just miss is that if we have great communication with our team, we're going to have long-term team members. And long-term team members are key because you don't have to continually train people. You get rid of that turnover. So I'd say if anyone listening has got a lot of turnover at their practice, I'd look at the way you're communicating with your team and it just right. asking them. I mean, I know I'm not going to be able to say this forever, but we have zero turnover in 7 years. We haven't lost a single person. That's now, we fired two people. But we fired them within 2 weeks of them starting because we knew right away that they weren't a fit. But yeah. And I think if you have the communication, I mean, you're going to find out about these issues. And that insurance coordinator I was talking about, she still works for me. This is it's been almost 3 years now since we had the conversation.
I've made it my life's work to study world-class dental practices. Mm-hmm. And I've had the privilege of being in quite literally, hundreds and hundreds of world-class dental practices. And there is absolutely a common denominator. There's a few common denominators across those world-class practices. But one of those is the fact that they just do not experience turnover. Mm-hmm. And now let's recognize there's some turnover that can be outside of your control. So, for right. example, if you have a young mom and they decide to start a family and she decides to be a stay-at-home mom, I understand that. You know, mm-hmm. I'm happy and sad when that happens, right?
Right.
You're happy for her and for the ability to be able to do that and the wonderful experience for her children. And then you're sad that you lose her, right?
Yeah.
And another example would be that I would kind of fall under turnover outside of your control, though I'm going to qualify this in just a minute, would be, let's say you have a female team member and her husband gets a job transfer and they have to move out of state. Mm. Now, interesting. I always said that that's kind of outside of your control, but I'm actually changing my thinking on that, Paul, because of something that happened recently in one of our clients' offices. May I share okay. that with you?
Yeah, go.
So, this is a client we've worked with for a number of years, brilliant practice. Literally any way you want to look at this practice is rocking. His lead front desk teamer, he doesn't really use the term office manager, but if I was using the term office manager, it would be her. Her husband had an opportunity to take a job transfer. And I'm thinking, oh no, here it goes. You know, she's going to probably have to move. And interestingly enough, they talked it over and decided her job was so good, he wasn't going to take the job and he was going to find a better job locally because wow. no way was he going to pull her away from this job. I mean,
That's
how
awesome.
Cool is that?
Yeah.
I mean, so those situations, maybe we could even change by having a practice that's strong enough that changes the conventional thinking on all of this.
Yeah.
So, you know, that you talk about communication and, you know, truth is many dentists struggle with communication. It probably wasn't an academic study of theirs, on the soft sciences, you know, on the humanistic sciences. If you had to share some communication tips, with our listeners, what would those be?
So, I mean, the first thing, like we talked about, is just create a safe place for them to contribute, because you got to realize that every time somebody says something, every time someone speaks up in a meeting, they're taking a little bit of a risk that they could say something that's not very smart. So don't ever make someone feel stupid when they say something and contribute to the group, because we want our practices to innovate. We want to grow, and we need to create a safe place. So I would say that's the first thing.
Oh, man. May I just like piggyback on that and say ditto? Absolutely. I mean, that's what I think created the environment for such a productive team meeting today at LifeSmiles, is they all felt like they were in a safe place, that they wouldn't be criticized for saying something that was, you know, in their mind, dumb. You know, they felt it was a safe place. So, yeah, absolutely. And I think there's ways to do that. I mean, we can talk about it, create a safe place, but let's talk about how to do that. Well, one way to do that is to be a good listener. And to realize that diversity in your practice is actually a blessing, because you've got team members that'll bring in different perspective. And sometimes that perspective might be just what you need to hear to make a breakthrough in the practice.
Right.
And so, you know, not only, appreciate diversity, but embrace diversity, and, you know, create an environment where people are motivated to tell you what they think. And it's just a priceless bit of feedback.
Yeah. And I would say too, Gary, is that a big thing is how we respond when people give us criticism. And are we asking our team for criticism? Like, I always ask someone, say, tell me what I can do better. What can I do better? Oh, no, you're great. You're doing everything great. Give me one thing. I force them. Give me one thing. Criticize me. Hurt my feelings. Come on, give it to me. And it's been occasionally where they, you know, they'll say something about, I'll tell you just an example from today. And, so I'm adding a part-time hygienist, and the other one of my associate doctors goes, well, did you talk to the other hygienist? 'Cause they don't even think they're busy enough. And I'm like, well,
what are you thinking, doc?
And I go, well, they don't get paid on production, and I don't send them home when they don't have patients, so they don't have anything to worry about. And she's like, well, I think you should talk to them. I'm like, well, I don't need to talk to them because I don't need to please everybody here. And I was getting defensive, you know? And you got to watch yourself, because when you start getting defensive, you're shutting people down from giving you that feedback. So, I mean, the safety thing, it's a lot like trust. You can't just turn on safety. You've got to like build it conversation after conversation. And trust is, sometimes people are slow to give it, and it's either faster to take it away. So you got to be careful.
You know, you hit a key point about, I think it's human nature when you're challenged. I think the natural defense mechanism is to become defensive.
Mm-hmm.
And at all costs, we need to resist that, whether it be communication coming from a team member or coming from a patient.
Right.
We need to, yet the natural response is to become defensive. And you want to really avoid that. We had a situation happen in our practice that I'd like to share with you, Paul, and our listeners, that kind of demonstrates this. We had a new patient come in, and one of our assistants just didn't feel good about this guy. She just didn't. She was getting vibes and sing, you know, you've gotten those. She just didn't feel good. And she said, you know, Dr. Nelson, can I talk with you for a minute? And so they went into his office, and she said, listen, and this is a young dental assistant, and it took a lot of courage to have this conversation. And she said, Dr. Nelson, I don't know what it is, but I just do not feel good about this guy. I've got a bad feeling. Mm-hmm. And, Paul said, you know, thanks a lot for sharing that with me. But, you know, this was a patient that had some dentistry done somewhere else, and he was complaining about the veneers that were done somewhere else. And Paul said, but his complaints have merit. And I can kind of see his point. I think I can help him. So he kind of, you know, he took that hero's cape and, you know, put that Superman cape on.
But it's easy to put on sometimes.
I can do this. I can do this. Anyway, the long story short, seats the first veneer case, the guy is totally unhappy with it. Totally unhappy. And Paul, what is it that you don't like? And he goes on telling Paul, so well, you know, now that you mention it, I can kind of see that. He's got to cut off the veneer case, okay, and redo the veneer. So we're already upside down in this case, right? Mm-hmm. So now we learned our lesson. When it's time to place the second 10 units of veneers, he has the patient sign a release form saying he's approved of them. He wants them to be seated. You know, so if you're okay, we learned from that. We're not going to do that one again. Anyway, what Paul didn't know is behind the scenes, and I don't mind sharing, true confession sometimes, because if it can help someone else, maybe it's worthwhile sharing. So it's not, everything's not all rosy in my practice, and I don't mind sharing the foibles that we have now and again. Well, behind the scenes, this patient was stringing along the front desk when it came to payment. And he had made a down payment, but was kind of stringing him along. He was coming up with an excuse every time about why he didn't bring the payment today. And anyway, my team's really sharp on this. And so when it came time to schedule seating for the second veneer case, they said, you know, just please be prepared to bring a check in. We'll take care of that at the beginning of the appointment. And, you know, if you don't bring in a check, we won't be seating those veneers. I mean, there's no way to sugarcoat that. That was the deal. Right. Mm-hmm. So he comes in on that last appointment, brings a check in, hands a check to the front desk. Front desk takes the check, puts it in the deposit envelope, and I go to make the deposit later that night. You probably know where this is going, or at least have a hint. I look in the deposit bag and the check isn't signed.
Whoops.
Not signed. And I am not going to fault my team member for this because, you know, in hindsight, we'll look to make sure it's signed. But I mean, how many, you know, you take the check, you assume it's signed. There it is. Boom. Goes in the album. So the next day I asked my team member, I said, would you please call him? It was probably an oversight on his part. Now I knew full well it was not an oversight, but I said, just give him a call, ask him to come in and sign the check so we can deposit it. She calls him and he says, well, that was not an accident. I deliberately did not sign that check. I will never be coming in to sign that check. Good luck getting paid for me. Okay.
Nice guy.
Yeah. I just want true confessions. Okay. True confessions. Here it is. This happened in the last year in my practice. So I sit down with Paul and Paul said, what should we do? I said, well, Paul, we have two choices. We could pursue hard collections after this guy, and there are some things we could do and perhaps get paid. Or we could learn a lesson and move on. And I was trying to present the choices non-judgmentally so he couldn't like pick up what my suggestion was. Mm-hmm. And he said, Gary, what do you think I should do? And I said, remember, it's we on this because, you know, I'm a partner. It's my decision, you know, too in this. And as painful as this is, Paul, I suggest you write it off because every time we go to chase this, there's going to be emotion welling up in you. Mm-hmm. And the emotion is not going to be positive. It's going to be hard to switch out of that negative emotion filled vibe and treat the next patient that you see with your normal, you know, passion and compassion. You know, I said, let's take our lumps and move on. And he said, you're right. I need to do one thing first. And he called that dental assistant into his office and apologized. He said, I just want to say, I'm sorry for not listening to your message. And she said, that's okay. It's no worries. You know, as a young dental assistant. And he said, no. I feel bad. I want to make sure that your voice is always heard in my practice. And somehow I didn't listen. I put my Superman cape on thinking that this was a clinical issue that I could solve. And in fact, it was an emotional issue and I needed to heed your advice. So please feel comfortable coming to me in the future with any kind of insights that you have about our patients. And it was a wonderful communication because she felt heard, respected, and Paul learned one the hard way.
Yeah. Yeah, that's tough. And just to kind of piggyback on what you said is that when you get on the Facebook groups,
oh God.
I know this was not the point of the story, but I can't tell you how many times, like maybe once every other week, somebody's posting something about this happened and the patient did this and they don't think they should be charged, but that's total BS and I need to charge them. And And I'd say that everyone's spot split 50-50. Like half the people be like, just write it off. Who cares? Mm-hmm. And sometimes it's like we're $100. Yeah. And half the people are just, it's like you said, there's an emotional thing with money and just, no, just let it go.
And if you've been taking, you know, imagine put yourself in, you know, Dr. Nielsen's place, my Paul, how would mm-hmm. you feel, Paul, if you were taking advantage? You feel horrible. You well up energy and there's no way to really purge that, in human nature. You know, so right. It's like, you know what, just get rid of it and be done with it. And, you know, it's an expensive lesson, but move on because the next patient may be an amazing full mouth reconstruction. You know?
Yep. Absolutely.
So we were talking about communication tips, talk about safe place. If you would keep building on that list, if you would.
Yeah.
We went down a fun little rabbit trail.
Yeah. Okay. So I would say the second thing, I mean, first thing is create a safe place. And the second thing is just talking to your team. And you kind of touched on that before, but I always like to use the example, like Captain John Phillips, like he's the hostage on that boat.
Right.
And they got those SEALs like pointing those sniper rifles. And it wasn't Obama on the phone saying, shoot now, you know, they had to have the ask to communicate with the people that were on the scene. So it's talk to your people. Talk to your, I mean, like I said, assistants and hygienists, you talk to them all day long, but talk to your front desk. They're on the front lines. They know what's going on. They know what the problems are. And if you, they're not going to tell you unless you ask. And
you know, Paul, the front desk can, our administrative team members can feel a disconnect to the doctor that is often not experienced by clinical team members because they're working more closely with the doctor.
Yeah.
And it can be accidental. The doctor's not ignoring them, but you know, literally, many days, the situation in practice can be that you see your team in the morning huddle and you see them to say good, the front desk team, and you see them in the morning huddle and then you see them to say goodbye at the end of the day. And that was it. Mm-hmm. And so I think you have to intentionally connect with your admin team members so that they don't have this feeling of being disconnected to the doctor.
Right. And we want to be candid with them. We want to give them feedback. We want to train them and we want them to be candid with us as well. But that's a difficult thing to do if there's no relationship established.
Yeah.
And it's hard to establish that relationship when you're never in the front.
Right.
So I can tell you, like I said, I went down to 2 days a week just recently, just about a month ago. And I've been from Wednesday is now my new admin day. Thursday is my optional admin day, but I try to get in there anyway. But I'm making a conscious effort to go up to the front and just, you know, just have some conversations and just talk, just non-dental, non-work, mm-hmm. because it's hard. I've got a lot of front desk people. And I can tell you that some of these new hires, I don't know too much about. And that kind of scares me.
Right. Right. That's another tip that I would throw in there is actually learn about your team members.
Yeah.
You know your team members, you know their spouse's name, know their kids' names, know what's going on in their extended families, know what's going on in their life. I mean, that's a deep sign of respect. Mm-hmm. And you know, in some practices I've seen that just hasn't existed. And I would say that's a mistake.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think it's easier when you're small. As you get bigger, it gets a little bit more difficult. And as you get busier and up to capacity, it has to be almost have to be more intentional about it because it's really hard to get. It's easy to get away with that to have that get away.
Back to the second suggestion of talk to your team. For those solo dentists that are listening and they're saying, well, I could see how Dr. Etchison could do this because, you know, he's only working 2 days a week. He can connect with his team. So I'd like to suggest a solution for you solo dentists that are maybe working 4 days a week, 4.5 days a week clinically. One thing I would suggest you do is once a month, have an offsite meeting. Maybe it's a breakfast meeting or a lunch meeting with your admin team. So that you can just connect with them, you know, and do that once a month. It could be a lunch, it could be a breakfast. It could be, you know, something you do at the end of the day, but just connect with them, make an intentional effort to connect with them. It'd be
but
time.
I,
very
I can't
well
shut down production, Gary. How am I going to do it?
Yeah, exactly. Well, this is one of those ones and I appreciate the, you know, the comment, Paul, because that's what some are thinking.
Yeah.
I would frame it a different way. You can't afford not to. You can't afford not to. And, you know, frame it from that perspective. And any other communication tips?
Yeah, I mean, that was going to be my next one is just have meetings. You got to have the meetings. Like we do a monthly meeting and then I do every other week I have a meeting with my team leads and we do quarterly all day meetings, which we go do something fun and we have about a four or five hour meeting and then we go do something fun together. And I mean, typical Friday, we might do $15,000-$20,000. But I agree with you, Gary. I mean, it's worth it. And you don't see how much it's worth it until you start doing it. And even for the 4 day a week dentist, I was doing these things when I was 4 days a week. I was never five. I could never do that. It was just way too much dentistry for me. But when I was solo doc 4 days a week, doing maybe 1.6 a year, we spent time and we did that. But it was a challenge and it took a lot of energy. And I can tell you, when we did the startup and I was the only doc doing 4 days a week and doing all this management and team building and stuff, I wasn't home very much, and I wasn't present at all in my personal life. And that's something I had to learn the hard way.
Sure.
I had to kind of sit and take a good look in the mirror and say, what are you doing with yourself? All you do is work. But yeah, I get it. And I really sincerely believe that if you really want to grow an excellent practice, you have to give time to these things that don't give that immediate production. You have to do the team stuff. And I've noticed from my podcast, just a lot of the really successful dentists that I talk to, a lot of them are 3 day dentists.
Yeah.
They don't do 4 or 5 days.
Paul and Tim in my practice, we work in by design, a 3 day work schedule. Paul works Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Tim works Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Mm-hmm. I also want to echo something you said earlier on the 5 day week. Over the years, I have probably consulted with 1,000 dentists, and no exaggeration, who were working 5 days a week. And I made the suggestion of, let's go to 4, and I will show you how you will produce more 4 days a week than you ever produced in 5. And
right.
Knock on wood, every single time that was the case. Every single
Absolutely.
Time. And when we went from 4 day weeks to 3 day weeks with Paul and Tim, the same thing. We increased production. It didn't go backwards. So we're producing, with basically 6 doctor days. So Paul 3 days a week, Tim 3 days a week, 6 doctor days a week. That's the equivalent of a doctor and a half if you count 4 clinical days as full time, which I believe, that would be the definition of full time. We're mm-hmm. doing the kind of numbers we're doing on a doc and a half. And it's there. It's possible. You need to have really good systems. We're going to get to those in a minute, but it's absolutely there. Hey, before we get to systems, Paul, would mm-hmm. you share a tip or two on leadership? You mentioned, a lot of that first half of the book is communication and leadership. Share some takeaways on leadership with our listeners.
Well, I think leadership always starts with the stuff that nobody wants to do, like the mission statement, the vision, and in establishing the core values. But ultimately, I think a lot of it just has to do with consistency. I mean, there's all these leadership words that we hear and people roll their eyes and are like, oh yeah, be a good person. And ultimately, it is just be a good person, be a person of your word. Always, if you say you're going to do something,
crazy
do
idea.
It.
Crazy idea.
Yeah, right?
Where do you get this stuff?
Yeah, and you got to,
where do you come up with this stuff?
I don't know. Okay. And then, you got to be big picture thinking. Sometimes we get so caught up on being right. Everybody wants to be right. Stop being right. Be the first person to apologize. I always tell people that, apologizing first does not make you weak. I mean, everybody's been in like an argument with their spouse or boyfriend, girlfriend, or one of their friends that they lasted like 4 days where, you're reading into every text, like, what does this really mean? Or you're just mend the relationship, say sorry. And then you go through this big 4 day emotional thing and it sucks. And once you get done with it, you're like, man, why didn't we just hash this out like 4 days ago? Right. And we do this in our practice until somebody actually leaves. And you're like, yeah, I knew they were going to quit anyway. And you could have saved them. You could have kept, you just had to say sorry. And I'm not going to say that I say sorry for things that aren't my fault, but it comes down to that extreme ownership that everything that happens at the practice is my responsibility. And that is the foundational thing of leadership, that Jocko Willink, yep. Extreme ownership. Everything that happens is me. Every single thing. And people will be like, well, no, my team will be like, no, it's not your fault. It was mine. I'm like, no, it's. I'm going to take the blame for this. We need to come up with a better system. I should have communicated this better. I should have communicated better expectations, because every disagreement that we have with our team is going to be just somebody letting down on expectations. And we can't expect anyone to fulfill our expectations if we're not communicating them. So, own everything, communicate, be responsible for everything, because you're the leader and everything falls on your shoulders.
Right. Hey, I'll add to that. My favorite business book, and I have 500 business books in my library. Mm. My favorite business book is the book Good to Great by Jim Collins. I'm sure you're familiar with that, Paul.
Yeah.
And I'm likely our listeners are familiar with it as well. But there's a wonderful leadership manifesto in a chapter of that book. And he talks about the five levels of leadership. And doctors, I would just encourage you to read that chapter. It's called Good to Great is the book. Jim Collins is the author. And he talks about level five leadership. And you want to aspire to and grow to a level five leader. And he talks specifically about what it is. But I'll summarize it very briefly. A level five leader is someone that is supremely competent, extremely good at what they do, but they also maintain their humility. So someone that's very competent, but they maintain their humility. And that, and he talks a lot about, you know, what it is about those two qualities that make a supreme leader. But I'd encourage our listeners to read that book and go brush up on it if you've read it a while back, and use that as a bit of a manifesto on how to develop your own leadership skills. Level four, by the way, he'll say, hey, the truth is, if you can aspire to a level four leader, you'll have a lot of success. But level four is characterized as not the ultimate form of leadership, but certainly a high level of performance. Level four is defined as the genius with 1,000 helpers. Mm-hmm. Genius with 1,000 helpers. And the truth is that characterizes many dental practices. And understand the distinction between the two of those and understand how much more effective the level five leadership is and aspire to that level five. Even though you'll get a certain modicum of success with level four, but you'll get geometrically more success with level five.
Yeah. And, you know, a lot of dentists, they lead with that fear. You know, they just, you know, it's my practice. I'm the boss. I make the rules.
My name's on the door.
Yeah. My name's on the door. You know, my way or the highway. Yeah. And that doesn't ever work.
No.
Not for long.
Well, let's switch gears over to this systems for just a minute. You mentioned seven categories of systems. Would you list those one more time if you would?
Yeah. Phone skills, patient experience, financing is the third, scheduling, clinical skills, collections, and then your reactivation or recall system. So it's kind of just sending, how does the patient move through the practice? Because it's like, you got to start with phone skills. That's got to be the first one because, you know, and we just had this come up at our practice just recently. We grew very fast last year. We were hiring a lot of people because we knew we were expanding to 11 operatories. So we had to add a lot of people. And I was doing some pay-per-click stuff and I'm looking at the stats and we were converting about 30% of these new patient calls. I was like, oh my gosh, like what's going on? And then you know, we listened to them and I advocate listening to phone calls once a week, but that's just something that just got away from me. We got busy and I started doing other projects and I wasn't doing it as much. Now my office manager is doing it since we've had this recent like holy moly moment. But it was pretty eye opening. It wasn't awful, but it was just that it was really eye opening on what was happening. So we did some trainings. We had some discs that we listened to as a team. I read some of the chapters from my book that talks about phone skills, and now we're listening to them. And I can't tell you how many of the people in the front desk, they just don't realize what they say sometimes. And you got to hear it. It's almost like we see these patients and they say, this tooth never bothered me until I saw it once in a picture on Facebook. Like they just were unaware of it. And in our front desk, they do the same thing as the phone. I had one, my insurance coordinator, she used to, her thinking word was okay when she started typing. So she'd be like, oh, can you give me your name, please? And they give the name and she started typing. She'd go, okay. and I brought her back and I'm like, what are you doing here? And she's like, oh my gosh, I'm typing, but that sounds ridiculous. I'm like, I know. So, but she was completely unaware of it. So, right. Yeah, but if you can't get past the phone, man, you can't get the patients in the door. You got to start with phone skills. So that's the first system. I know I went on a tangent there and you just asked for the seven, but
no, that was perfect.
It goes
in
order. Perfect.
Hey, I want to tease our listeners about something you comment at the very end of the book. And you and I knew from the moment we met that we were kindred spirits, Paul. And I knew that because one of the things you say in the book is that private practice is not dead.
Yeah.
In fact, not only is it not dead, there's never been a better time.
I totally agree.
I knew we were in kindred spirits when you said that. And you're a fellow champion of entrepreneurship in dentistry. And I just want to take a minute and say thanks, man. Thanks for your role model of this. Thanks for your passion. Thanks for writing this book. Hey, share with our listeners where they can get the book.
Yeah, then get on Amazon. We got Kindle, we've got paperback, and we have the audiobook, which I didn't do originally, but so many people asked about it. And the audiobook outsells the print books, which is pretty crazy to me.
So I'm going to go on Amazon and put a link to your book on Amazon so that anyone that's listening to this, you can just go to the show notes. The show notes are at thrivingdentist.com. And in the show notes, just click on the Amazon link to purchase Paul's book. And here's my suggestion. And Paul didn't know I was going to do this. This is unrehearsed, unscripted. Buy a copy for every one of your team members and ask them what format they would like. Do they want a Kindle format? Do they actually want the physical book, or would they like the Audible copy? Buy whatever they want. And I want you to do this as book club in your practice. And what book club is that you'll read the book together as a team. When we do this, we do about 4 books a year at my practice. And the way we do book club is we pick the book, we buy it for the team, and then we decide, you know, it's going to be this day. It might be Tuesday at lunch. And we bring in a working lunch, and we talk about the reading assignment. The reading assignment might be it might be a chapter. Your book is a very easy read, so it might be a chapter. It might even be 2 or 3 chapters because it reads very quickly. If it was a more technical read, it might be 10 pages, 12 pages. Don't burden your team members. Make it something that's easy for them to do. And in the book club meetings, you're going to do 2 things. You're going to talk about what did I learn in that reading assignment? What did I learn in chapters 1, 2, and 3? And then perhaps even more importantly, what can we apply in our practice? And I will just take the leap in faith. Your practice will go through a massive transformation if you do Dental Practice Hero as book club in your practice. Watch the cool things that transpire as a result of that book club. So I'll put it in show notes. I'll put it in an Amazon link. And I like to think that our listeners take action, Paul. So I hope we generate a lot of book sales for you.
Thank you, Gary. I appreciate that.
Yeah. Anyway, I want to thanks for all you do, Paul, man. Appreciate you. Appreciate your guidance, your wisdom, your modeling of this, and your voice about entrepreneurship and the fact that you're another champion of entrepreneurship in dentistry.
Yeah, man, this was fun. I was looking forward to this for a long time. I really wanted to be on the show, and I'm glad you finally had me. And yeah, we should do it again.
Hey, if our listeners want to reach out to you, how's the best way for them to reach out to you?
Find me on Facebook. You can find me on Facebook, send me a friend request, or you can just email me directly at dentalpracticeheroes@gmail.com.
Perfect. Hey, I'm going to put both the Facebook link and your email address link in the show notes. So again, one click, we'll take our listeners directly to you. And hey, as a listener, send Paul an email or send him a comment on Facebook and just tell him how much you appreciate this interview, and thank him for sharing his wisdom and writing a cool book. Hopefully we can blow up your server with some emails from to you. Would that be okay?
I'd love that, man. Sometimes, you know, as being on a podcast and doing things like this out there, sometimes it's a thankless job sometimes. And I always, 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 always appreciate when people reach out and just say, hey, I bought your book, really liked it. And yeah, always so thankful for when people reach out to me.
Hey, especially those that are not in the United States, send Paul an email and it'll be kind of fun for him to track how many countries he hears from. That'd be fun, wouldn't it, Paul?
Yeah.
Looking forward to it. Email address, dentalpracticeheroes@gmail.com.
That's correct.
Yeah. Cool. Well, hey, I want to thank our listeners. We love what we do here at Thriving Dentist Show. We couldn't do it without you. 3 things you can do to support our work. Number 1, you can tell a colleague about the podcast. And while you're at it, tell them about Dental Practice Heroes podcast. Secondly, jump on iTunes and write us a review. If you haven't done that already, I'd appreciate that. It allows more dentists to be able to find us, kind of like a Google review in your practice. So jump on iTunes and write us a review. And 3, hit subscribe. Subscribe is available on iTunes. It's also available on Google Play or whatever your podcast directory of choice is. When you hit subscribe, it means that every Wednesday when we upload a new show, it'll be automatically uploaded for your listening convenience. On that note, let me take a second and say thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes. better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride. Don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.